Welcome, everyone. Hello. Welcome to the configuration management session. We will talk about the theory and practice of configuration management in Drupal 8. There's another session right now about how to organize camp. So if you want to go to that one, then you're in the wrong room. So let's start. We are from Nuvole, 100% Drupal company. We're a distributed team in Italy, Belgium, and the Czech Republic. Our clients are also from different countries and even different continents. And our projects are mostly for international organizations and institutions. And they require fast delivery, so we have several developers working on the same project simultaneously, and we need to frequently push the stuff live. And of course, it needs to be safe and needs to work and needs to be reliable. So we face a couple of challenges, mostly with the remote collaboration and keeping track of all the configuration and publishing updates live. And Drupal has been in the core of the organization of our company, and Nuvole has been already since the beginning a proponent of the configuration management, and you will see in Drupal 8 this has been a real thing and been recognized as the right thing to do. So, the evolution of configuration management. Don't worry, this is still the beginning, and we start so that everybody's on the same page, but it will get much more advanced towards the end. So historically, the configuration and the content are kept in the database. And for various reasons, also Drupal 8 keeps the configuration in the database. But in Drupal 6, the start was with features. It became possible to somehow export configuration. In Drupal 7, the features was more mature. But in Drupal 6 and Drupal 7, the configuration in features is imperative, which means it's code and the logic execution. And in Drupal 8, the configuration and content are clearly separate, and the configuration is text-based or declarative, so you cannot run logic in the configuration. We all know the downsides of the database-driven workflow. So you share the database if you work on the same project, and it's of course bad because you mix configuration and content and you lose track of what configuration has changed. And of course, theoretically, you could still do that, but you know, if you do that, then you don't deserve nice things. In Drupal 7, I think almost everybody does that with features. It also has its flaws, because features is fundamentally not made for that. Features is made for packaging and reusing configuration, and Drupal 7 doesn't have anything remotely close to that in core, so features needs to take care of the export as well. Not everything is exportable, and you have to whitelist the configuration you want to export and share between the different environments. And this is theoretically also still possible in Drupal 8, but again, if you want nice things, then you do it the way Drupal 8 intends to do things. So let's take a closer look at configuration management. In Drupal 7, most of the things lives in the database. In Drupal 8, most of the things live also in the database, but they're clearly separate. And the important part here is to differentiate between state, config, and content. So config is the stuff that you want to share between the different environments of the same site, whereas state is something that is instance specific. For example, the canonical example is when the cron has been last run, that would be state and not configuration. And of course, content is the things that the users add and which is not considered to be development or something that you want to keep track of as part of the development cycle. There's a config core module that allows you to do the configuration management. And it is a part of the standard profile. And it provides this import-export functionality. The important part here is that it's the same site. So then you have the optional and the original configuration, as we say. They can be provided by modules. So if you enable a module, then the configuration it provides will get into the site configuration. And from then on, the site owns the configuration. It's a very important concept to understand when you come from features, because in a feature, the feature would own the configuration. In Drupal 8, the site owns the configuration. And they're in YAML files, so the text files I mentioned before. So this is an example of a simple YAML file. And you see it's both machine readable and human readable. This is for the system site, so you have the site name there and the simple configuration. There's two concepts of the configuration. It's the active store. This is what the site uses. And there is a sync store, which is how the configuration management or the config module can detect what is new and what needs to be imported. In the beginning, when you install the site, this is empty. But when you upload a tarball or use Drush, it will get populated. They both have the same structure. And the active store is in the database by default. And this has three reasons. The first one is the speed, because read from the database is faster. The second one is to protect you from messing with the active configuration. So you're less tempted to edit the active configuration directly when it's in the database than when it's in the files where you see them. And the third part is if it's not in the files, it's also more secure, because it's less probable that someone will stumble across them. Whereas the sync store is in files, and you see here it has the same structure, essentially. So setting up the sync store is in settings.php. You define it with this nice variable, essentially. And the best practice is to keep it outside of the webroot and in your version control. By default, when you install Drupal can only write to the site's default files directory. So it will, at the moment, try to create a folder there with a very long and random name, and then save the name in this file. So when you export the configuration, it will be stored in the sync directory. And then the UI can tell you what is the difference, but also Drush can tell you the difference. And then it will become active when you install, when it gets into the active directory. And when this happens, when the sync configuration becomes active, then all the modules that are newly enabled will get installed. If you add a new field or a new content type, then the new database tables will be created. And an important aspect here is that if a file is removed from this directory, then that means the configuration that corresponds to that is removed. So it is always the whole site configuration is considered there. And this is also an important part why you shouldn't directly edit the active configuration, because the database tables need to be adapted, for example. Configuration can have dependencies. So the configuration object can depend on other configuration. Here, the example here is from the view mode of an article. And it depends on the fields that the article has. But it can also depend on modules, like the image module or the text module. And it can also depend on content, but we will see that in a later stage. This concept of the original configuration, it's in the config install directory of the module that provides it. It's essentially the same configuration that you have in the active directory, with small differences, like the missing UUID. And it's important when the module is enabled, and from then on, it's ignored. And it lives in the site, and it can get modified by either other modules or by the person clicking around. And an important part is that it needs to depend on the module that provides it, because it will not get deleted when you uninstall the module. So if you have configuration in config install that doesn't depend on the module, then when you uninstall the module and install it again, it will not work. For that, there's another option, and it's the optional configuration. And you put it in config optional, and it will get installed when all the dependencies of the configuration are met. An important part an example is here, the node module comes with a view, but the node module doesn't depend on views. But when the views module is enabled, then the view that comes with the node module will be enabled as well. And how Drupal knows this is with the schema. So the view schema defines the views. And the schema that the module that provides the schema is the one that is checked for when. So each time you enable a module, it will check through all the config optional directories and see if they provide configuration that the new module has a schema for. Configuration also automatically depends on the module that provides it. So the first part of the name, so here, for example, views view front page .yaml, it says it depends on views, because that's the kind of configuration that it comes with, or that where the schema is that defines it. So we have a quick guided example on how this works. And an important part for this is the reference use case. So it's keeping the site online at all time, having a development testing environments for new configuration, and exporting the changes between the environments. And important, it's not for transferring partial configuration between different sites. It's the same site with the same site name, with the same email addresses, the same site, but in different environments. So you install the site, you make a backup, you reinstall from the backup or with the config installer. We will get to that later. Then the production lives on. On the development, you change something. Then you export it with, you can also do that with the UI, but this is an advanced session, so you will use Drush. And then you commit it to Git, and you push it. On the production, you pull it. And you can review the difference. And you can import the configuration. And that's already it. It's not complicated. Of course, configuration comes with an API. Let's look at that next. There's two different types of configuration. The configuration objects and configuration entities. Configuration objects are for things that there's only one of. So for example, the site name or the site settings, you can only have one site name. And configuration entities are like content entities where you can have multiple things off. So you can have more than one view, for example, or more than one content type, or more than one taxonomy vocabulary. They both extend their own base classes. So if you want to create your own, then you just extend those. Configuration can be mutable and immutable. So normally when you work with configuration, you just want to get the configuration. You want to know what it is. And it is retrieved in a read-only mode. This is because configuration can be overwritten. We'll get that to that next. And when you want to get the configuration, you will get it with the overrides. And you can also get it without them, but in most cases you want to know what the configuration is. But if you have a form, you want to have the mutable configuration, and this is without the overrides, because otherwise the overrides would bleed into your configuration when you submit the form, which is bad, of course. Imagine API keys and so on. So there's different ways of overriding it. One is the on the fly. So it's the config variable. It's the same as the conf variable, basically, in Drupal 7. It's very useful in settings.local.php, where you specify the environment-specific configuration. So, for example, the error level, you want to set it to verbose on your development, and in production you want to just show, oh, there's something wrong, but not necessarily why. The overridden configuration, you can also override it with the user interface. For example, the language system uses the override to specify the language specific things. So the language system uses a config override to translate the configuration. When you use the API, you can get both. So you can get the original and you can just get the other one that we had before. Here's an example on how this would work. All right, that was for the theory part. Now let's see practice.
So I'll address up if you have any questions. All right, so let's start with features for Drupal 8. So features was like the only way we had in the past to actually deploy configuration, as Fabian said already. That was, the only choice we really, really had. So the aim of feature was always twofold. I mean, you was meant to package things together that would belong to the same use case, but was not really meant for deployment. And we ran into all kinds of issues while doing that. Now, the features for Drupal 8 wanted to catch the occasion of actually getting rid of this ambiguity and just go for one road only, which is only the packaging, because the configuration management takes care of all the rest. Right? This is a really, really important concept, and we really cannot stress this enough. So for features for Drupal 8, first of all, it depends on a module, which is a configuration update manager. And this configuration update manager is a module that helps you to confront the configuration that has been imported and that is live on your site with where it came from, right? So if you have, for example, a module that provides you with some configuration, you install this module, this configuration gets imported in your site. From that moment on, it's part of the configuration management workflow. Then you change that configuration, you work with the site, etc. The moment you want to take this configuration back to your module, you can use the configuration update manager to see the diff, to extract it, and then to put it back in your module, to then package again your module to share it in another project of yours. And features is basically sits on top of this configuration update manager, and it's just focused on packaging configuration for a use purpose. And it's the nice part is it's meant to be a development module. So while in Drupal 7 features were depending from the features module, in Drupal 8 they do not depend anymore, right? So features for Drupal 8 actually generates modules, not anymore features if you want. You can just get rid of it, it's just a development module. So what's new? So basically, there have been a lot of concepts that were introduced in features for Drupal 8. And this concept actually comes from the usage that the community did of features through all the years in Drupal 7. And you can really see a reflection of the use case that emerged during all these years in the way that features for Drupal 8 was actually built. For example, the first is like the assignment plugin. So this is an interesting concept. The features for Drupal 8, you can decide how to cut, to slice your features. This is a common problem that we had for features for Drupal 7. For example, you had like, you would organize your features by content type, right? So you would have like name of your project, underscore, article, for example. And that feature will contain everything that related, that goes around the article content type. Or maybe you want to organize your features by type of configuration. So you would have like a feature for views, a feature for context, a feature for permissions. This is another way of slicing it, okay? We were always advocating the first one because it's just more manageable. But some cases you might want to have the other approach. So the assignment plugin actually gives you, you can define the way that the system offer to the way to generate features for you. So there is like an assignment plugin per content type. So if you enable that, then you can select, okay, I have this content type, generate the feature for the article content type, and then the site generates the features that goes around the article with all the dependencies. Or you can say assignment plugin views, so you can get all the views of a site in a feature. Then feature bundles. This is also very nice for reusing configuration from one project to another project. And it's pretty much about namespacing. For example, if you want, you can extract configuration from one project, bundle them into a feature, and use this feature in another project. Okay. Then features also enables, like features for Drupal 8 has also an interface, which is a separate module. This was not the case in features for Drupal 7. And it affords also a lot for naming convention, which in Drupal 7 was left to the care of the developers. So the new role for features is really like, it's a module for developers only. We were using features really, really extensively in Drupal 7, because we didn't have any other choice. But in Drupal 8, we don't need to use features. I mean, we didn't feel the need yet to use features. If you build a distribution, then you want to use features, because that's really a use case of packaging configuration together for the sole purpose of reusing it somewhere else. But if you build a website, you don't need features at all. You just need configuration management. It's more than enough for you. And then, because it's monolithic, you have one site, it belongs to that configuration, and it's global. Right, so this is really something to take care of. Okay, then there is an administration interface, which is in another place instead of the one for Drupal 7, and that's the most important thing, is not for deployment at all. So it just doesn't work. I mean, it's not meant to be a deployment module. You have configuration management for deployment. So basically how it works, when you enable your feature, it's just like a module. So you enable your feature, the configuration is staged to your active configuration. From that moment on, the site owns it. So if you want to export it for deployment, you will export using configuration management. In your sync directory, then you will push the sync directory on production, and then you will import using configuration management. And that's why you don't need features module in production ever. It's just really a development module like devel, for example. And yeah, exactly. So the feature workflow actually changed completely. It's really to package configuration and in for the purpose of reusing it in a in another project. And that's it, basically. So if you use it for deployment, it's just wrong. I mean, you really don't need it. Then, that's actually the workflow. So the project A, project B, they just share some features. So like you create your events feature that fits more or less all your clients' needs. And then you enable the events feature on project A and you enable the events feature on project B. From that moment on, they belong to the sites. So you don't re-exporting features. You just stage the configuration and then you have configuration management to manage all the life of your project. So this is the main differences. Now let's have a look to how, like way of working with configuration management. So, well, the first way of working is like being a team of developers. That's pretty much what we all do. So typical setup when you are a team of developers is that you share a Git repository for your project, of course, which contain both code and configuration, right? As we've seen earlier, you export configuration into a sync directory and you version that. Then it's advisable to install the site starting from the initial configuration that you export, right? This will allow developers that join the project later to start with the same configuration set that you are working on. And of course, it's really, really advisable to adopt a Git branching model. Configuration management, really, it's really bundled together to Git. Like, it's meant to be used with the correct Git workflow. It's really shines when you use with Git, because you can branch different configuration. You have feature branches where the different configuration exist. You can merge. You can diff. You can do everything. Also, YAML files helps you with this because they're very nice when it comes to diffing them, because it's really readable. So it's not XML or PHP or anything else. So how you bootstrap a project being a team of developers? So the roles are really like, we can distinguish between the first one who starts the project and all the rest, right? So the first developer has an additional responsibility of creating the starting environment, then all the rest of the team will then use, and also production will then use. So what the first developer does, it installs the site locally, of course, clearly, so with a standard profile maybe, or with your own profile if you have one. It starts to configure stuff if he wants, it's not required, and then he creates the first export. Right, so Drush configuration export, and then it will export the configuration in the directory that you set up in your setting PHP file, as Fabian told you earlier. Then it commits and pushes everything to the shared Git repository. From that moment on, the next developers that join, they will just clone the project, have config installer profile available. It's a contrib profile, contrib module, contrib project, that installed a site starting from already defined set of configuration, right? So you install this, instead of installing the site from the profile, it installed the site by re-importing the configuration that the first developer created for the team. Then after the site is installed, then just keep on working like that. This is the same way that you would deploy the first time on production. And because what you do in production, the first time you want to put your site in production, you are like yet another developer that wants to join the project, more or less. So you clone your code base, you just install with configuration config installer, and then you have the site there ready, right? Now, this is really the project bootstrap. Let's see the collaboration project. So how it works, before we had different features. Well, we used to organize our work in features. So I would work, for example, on feature core, and Fabian would work on feature article. So we would not really conflict and, you know, like step on each other's toes. But configuration management dumps all the configuration in one single directory, right? So you need a little bit of extra care now. So how it works? So you would, developer A would just start to work as a site builder, for example. So it would configure a view, add a content type, add some fields, etc. Once it's done, it runs Drush config export, or checks for short. Then, of course, it needs to share these changes with its teammates. So git add and git commit. Then developer B starts to work while developer A is doing that. So it does the same. It clicks around, adds another view, another content type. It exports configuration. At this moment, developer A decides to push. Then developer B also adds its changes and commit. It tries to push as well, but of course Git will complain at this moment, at this point of time. So what developer B does then? Git pull. But at this moment, Git will merge the two configurations, right? And you might have conflicts. It happens sometimes. They are not that frequent because configurations are very well structured. So at the end, if you really don't work on the same thing, you will have your own configuration. Your teams will have their own configuration as well. Of course, part of the same directory. But then sometimes you might get conflict. So what you do, you pull, you fetch, you merge, you resolve the conflict manually. So you have to manually edit the configuration file. They are very readable and really understandable, so there is nothing wrong with doing that. The only thing we need to remember always is that you need to validate your conflict resolution against Drupal, right? So if you don't do that, you might find yourself in having inconsistent configuration. And this should never, ever happen. So what you do, you re-import your configuration just to check for its validity, just to validate it, inspect and fix in case you need to change something else, and then export again. So by doing one import and one export, you are sure that the configuration is fine on your side too. Only then you are ready to share this with your team, not earlier, because if you do it earlier, you might risk that to push some inconsistent configuration. So always remember, when you pull and there is a merge, and conflict especially, you solve the conflict, you import, you re-export, and then you push. Okay? And you repeat this process again and again. So then at this point, developer A will get the work of developer B, and then he will then re-import the configuration running config import. Now, the production deployment. So deployment is very, very easy. The idea of having one single monolithic approach to configuration management in Drupal 8 is really, really a great idea. I mean, it's at the beginning we were used to consider like modularity as a virtue, right? As a something good, healthy for your project. But it's actually not when it comes to configuration. This allows us to really be sure that all the configuration is always exported whenever you run an export. Everything you click, you change, is exported. And if you have something you don't want to commit, to push, you just use Git for that. So if you dump, like you export your configuration, you say, yeah, but I should not have changed that view. I don't want to share that. Well, there is nothing easier than just Git checkout that file, and you push the rest. So it's very, very manageable. So on production deployment, for production deployment, it's pretty easy. You just pull the code from the master branch or whatever branch you're using at that moment, doesn't matter. You run UpdateDB, of course, because that's actually pretty critical, because UpdateDB ensures that the schema and the it's aligned before you import the configuration. So first update DB, always. And then you run the configuration import. So at this moment, you can do also the contrary. You can run drash configuration import before the update DB. This might result in some deadlocks and dangerous moments and stuff. But they're working on an issue to enforce all of us to use only this approach. So first update DB and then configuration import. How this works, that's the link. We are going to share this anyway, so you're going to be able to click on that link. They are going to include the schema number in configuration, not anymore as a state. You know, when you run the update DB, you get the last number of the update DB, the update N. This now is a state, so it's not a configuration, right? It's something that is specific for the instance. It's not shareable, but with this issue in core, that will be shareable. So this will force all of us to first run configuration update and then run the import. Otherwise, the import will never work. So they chose to set the way, the right way for all of us, which is healthy, again, very good idea. Because then we don't have any doubts. We have to work this way, all of us, and this is good. All this production deployment assumes that actually there is no configuration change on production. Because while in feature, a client could have added a block or a context, but since that configuration was not tracked in features, you would not care because your feature would not be overridden, right? In this case, it's different because anything that client or anywhere, anybody that works online on production changes, it gets into your sync directory, right? So it's all part of one monolithic configuration. So this is the second workflow example. Changes on production. How we deal with that now? Because everything that is clicked on production is forever there, is recorded. You need to deal with that. You cannot just ignore it. Especially because when you import configuration, it wipes everything. So every time there is an export and import, the storage of both sides are wiped out. Right? So for the file system, of course, you don't care. You have Git, so you can always restore. But for the database, if you don't have a dump, then you're done. You're doomed. So how does this change comparison with the team of developers? Well, it's completely the same, of course, until that. So if you have a client that goes around and clicks and change stuff and places blocks and stuff, you are going to have to deal with that. Because changes on production are development. Any change is now development, okay? It's not anymore like we feature that it was just configuration that is not tracked, so we cannot care about it. No, it's development. This is actually very beneficial because you can track what is happening on production, which is very good anyway, right? And decide then. So you have two options to control the situation and make sure that you can manage this. The first is the most obvious, you lock configuration changes on the live side. So nothing is, no configuration can change can ever happen on a live site, right? The second option is you export, before deployment, you export the live configuration from the live site, the active configuration of the live site, and you check for changes. And this uses Git, and then it's a manual resolution, of course. So the first one, yeah, and ideally it's really would be good to have one person dedicated to this, like the same guy, like the deployment manager or whatever you want to call. So the first option is locking configuration on production. This is not something that Core provides for us yet, but there is a module which is called Configured Only. Very simple, brainless, really. You just install that module and then add that setting in your setting.php, and that's it. The client cannot do any damage anymore, right? Then, if you need the client to change something because you need, this is the way we have to go across that. So, master, the client is a developer that you don't control. So it's the worst situation ever. He can do whatever he wants. And then you need to deal with it. And how you deal with it, this is just an idea. I mean, we can debate on branching model for the rest of the day, but more or less, it's just an example. You have the master branch. One way is you export a master branch as a kind of hotfix, and then you push it to develop. Another would be you have a dedicated branch for clients' changes, right? And then you use that to compare it on develop. It's maybe cleaner than this one. Okay, this is simpler to draw, so that was why we did that. So, but so then how would it work? You just export from a production, push on a branch, and then you fetch this branch, and we just compare. And once you're done, then you put on develop, you clean everything up, and you push again. You might want to enable read-only configuration only for this amount of time that you need to do all this mess, because maybe the guy will change again stuff. So with these two options, you can control the thing, I think. So then there is another topic that we want to show you, is like the development configuration. So how it works with development configuration. So you want to have, for example, the develop module only in the development environment, right? But that's a module, which means that whenever it's installed, it stages configuration, which is in your Active Directory, which will get exported with all the rest of the configuration when the moment you run configuration export. You don't want to do that. So there is a way, actually, pretty simple. So when you run Drush configuration export, you can tell Drush to skip exporting the fact that the module is enabled, right? So the fact that the module is enabled is contained in one file. It's called core.extension.yaml. When you run Drush configuration export, that information gets there as well. And you can tell Drush, say, okay, just forget that this module is enabled in this, just don't consider it. But then you also need to remember that also development modules might have their configuration. So you need to ignore that. And for that you have Git. So you can Git ignore everything that starts with devel dot something, because the names, like the configuration, are namespaced correctly in Drupal 8. So we can use that as well. So with these tricks, you can have like local development configuration that is never pushed and share with your teammates. Then something else, so default content. This is actually pretty interesting. So configuration and content are not really two silos that are separated and they don't bother each other. No, they're actually very much interdependent. Think about taxonomy term that filters a view. This typical example, or a block that is on a page there. Those are content. Taxonomy term is content, content entity, and that block as well. It's a content entity. But you don't export content, right? So how we do that? Well, we have three solutions. So first of all, core is actually pretty nice to us in, for let us deal with this because it fires an event when the configuration is important and there is no matching between the content that is required by that configuration item and the configuration itself. The configuration will get imported, so your site will be with a new configuration, but your content won't be there. You can handle that there. So by answer to that event, you can, for example, create the block manually with the same UUID that you have in the configuration, of course. So you match the loose ends in this way, okay? If you, so this is one way. The second is like use migrate module, of course. So you dump your default content and you migrate, import the content as part of your deployment. Another one is using the default content contrib module. Default content contrib module at the moment only exports, like it allows you to import configuration at when you install the module. So when you install the module, the configuration, sorry, the content gets imported. But you can extend that pretty easily. We have done it for a project. We are going to write a blog post about that actually once this custom module is done. You can decide also very easily extend that and tell export all this content to this directory. And you, so you will have ideally a slash content directory in your code, like in your repository, with all your default content. And part of the deployment will be import the default content when you import configuration. And then you match the loose ends as well. All right? So these are like the three solutions. I think the most important is really the core event, because that's really the maintainers recognize the needs for this. And they provided us that to help us deal with that. There is also another hook, very, very interesting one. So until Drupal 7, we had update hooks, right? So update underscore n. Now we have another hook. It's post update underscore name. So you're not supposed to put numbers there. You're supposed to put a descriptive machine name of what you want to do with that post update. And Drupal core guarantees you that this update is run only once. Okay? This is run after all the hook updates are successfully run. So when the site is in a stable state, you can rely on that. And this hook is specifically offered to us to manipulate content only. It's really written in the documentation if you read it. It's like, if you need to manipulate content because you need to fix a field or something, don't use update hook, hook update n, use hook post update name. Right? So this is also a nice addition that we can use now to really cleanly work with content, not as part of the update hook, but as part of content manipulation, which is something different. All right, so then, well, we have compiled a list for you of interesting projects that help you work with configuration. We have seen some of those in our presentation. For example, configuration installer helps you install a site from your existing config, so that's part of our workflow in our company, for example. Read-only, it does what it says, so it prevents your client of messing up your configuration on live sites. Config update report changes between the original configuration offered by the module and its current active state. Config devel helps with developing configuration. You can export configuration for you in files and you can put them in modules, and it's a nice addition. The config tools is pretty nice. It does two things. One is that because the active storage is in the database, right? But if you enable that module, it also, so it runs checks for every click that you do in the interface. Whenever you save like a view or you put place a block, it does a configuration export to another directory. So you can always, you have like a way to inspect the active storage in files. It's just about this, which is can be useful as well. And then features, of course. So bundle configuration for users on different sites, and this is ideal for distribution, of course, and nothing else. So deployment, we've seen that is taken care of pretty well by configuration management. Okay, so Thank you. That's it. If you have any questions. No questions? Really? Cool. All right. Thank you, guys.